Along the way, the discourse and conversation and relentless dialogue with my church, the Catholic Church. When I started out in 1980 after Patrick was executed, and I come out of that execution chamber, throw up, never watched anybody be killed in front of my eyes before. And so I knew I was a witness, that I had to start telling the story. We need to start organizing Louisiana. And the one I had the most trouble from who wouldn't do anything was Archbishop Hannon, our archbishop, because he had been in the military and he believed in the death penalty. And we couldn't get our Catholic bishops to do anything because their statements were so watered down, the prosecutors would quote the bishop's statement. And that's not helpful. It is not helpful. Could have used some trained theologians here, but anyway. So the Catholic bishops had a statement, but if you notice in the statement from the beginning, it had huge, huge loopholes in it. They could see the practical things that were wrong and all. But principled opposition to the death penalty with no exceptions, Amnesty International had it, Universal Declaration of Human Rights had it, but not our Catholic teaching. Because they upheld the right of the state to take life and then just says practically it furthers violence. But man, I'm telling you, with all the loopholes in it. And so here goes in its relentless discourse. It's keeping the dialogue going. It's not giving up on the dialogue. It's keeping it going in the parish and with the archdiocese and with the people. Here's the thing I know about the church. The church is really the people. I mean, the church is really us. The believers are really us. And the leadership sometimes gets it and sometimes they don't, but it's the gospel that we have to be faithful to, all of us, all of us. And in the second book, Death of Innocence, I talk about this ongoing dialogue with my Catholic Church. And I talk about, in the second story, a man by the name of Joseph Odell, in Virginia, who was innocent. My second book is about two innocent people that I was there at their execution and accompanied them. Joseph Odell in Virginia was one of them. In Italy got involved. They sent delegations over from the Italian parliament to try to save Joseph Odell. Pope John Paul heard about it, got involved, and I got to have a direct in his lap dialogue, not me in his lap, but the letter I sent. It's amazing, but anyway, the letter got into him of 14 years of pastoral experience of being with people who were being killed. And pastoral experience is what we all need. Where when you're having the theological discussions and when you're having the human rights discussions, when you're having the civil rights discussion, when you have somebody who comes in and says, let me take you there. And two big questions to the Pope were, when I'm walking with a man to execution, he is rendered defenseless. He has chains on his legs. His hands are handcuffed to a belt around his waist. He's surrounded by guards, and they're going to take him down this hall, and they're going to strap him in, and they're going to kill him. And he says, sister, please pray that God holds up my legs. I said, Your Holiness, does the Catholic Church only uphold the dignity of innocent life? That's what the Catechism says, inviolable dignity of innocent life. Well, what about guilty life? And there is no dignity in this death. And then when you have a chance to dialogue, that we have to be really honest. And the honesty came through was, I said, you wrote a great encyclical in 1995, The Gospel of Life, and you took the death penalty and you pushed it to the edge, and the Pope did. And he said, because we have a way to defend society, that the death penalty should be rare, if not non-existent. The crucial thing with the theologians and the people who are going to debate this is, but are there any exceptions? Are there any exceptions? Because if there are exceptions and death is still on the table and government's going to be the one to decide if where the exception is, you still have the death penalty. And you have the designer death penalty arguments, including Obama including Obama, who has said, "I'm for the death penalty for a truly heinous crime, no doubt about the guilt," and an interesting thing that he puts in there, "in order that the full outrage of the people can be expressed." That's Obama's position on the death penalty that he stated when running for president. So here you had the Pope in his encyclical saying, it should be rare, if not non-existent, because we have a way to defend society, so we should use bloodless means. But he added in there, but in cases of absolute necessity, the state can execute. And I said, "Your Holiness, your words are going to be quoted for death, because whenever anybody wants to execute anybody, they will claim it's an absolute necessity." In Kenya, a 14-year-old girl that has a baby out of wedlock, after the baby is weaned, a hole is dug, the child is put in, and she's stoned to death. In Malaysia, when you walk into the airport, death penalty for drugs. Death penalty. You can't have it trusted up. Trust it to governments to decide when you do this or that, an absolute necessity in us, that we can kill you. You can't. You got to take it off the table. And providentially, the Catholic district attorney in New Orleans quoted the Pope's words in an interview. And he said, "We can't get enough death penalties in New Orleans." And here the Pope has said, in cases of absolute necessity, well, every death penalty we get is an absolute necessity. And I could put the words in his lap. Your words are going to be quoted for death. The Pope changed the catechism. The Pope did it. It wasn't Cardinal Ratzinger then, it was Pope John Paul. And then when the Pope came to St. Louis, the catechism was changed in 97. All this is in Death of Innocence, the whole story's in there of this whole journey. For the first time, the Pope addressed the death penalty. He'd been in the United States four other times. Because I remember when he was in Denver, we were trying to get the Pope to speak out, trying to get to the bishop there, to get to the Pope, speak out, speak out. And he never did, but now he did. And he put the death penalty for the first time with the other pro-life issues. And when he made the statement, you know, about the usual pro-life issues that we concerned about in life, like unborn children, born children, mothers of unborn children, euthanasia, physician-assisted suicide, he added, and no to the death penalty because it is cruel and unnecessary. And he added, even those among us who have done a terrible crime have a dignity that must not be taken from them. And when that happened in 99, then the Catholic bishops began to line up behind the Pope, and they have declared a campaign to end, Catholic campaign to end the use of the death penalty. And bishops did what bishops do. They printed a pamphlet for their campaign. They printed a really nice pamphlet, and they declared Catholic campaign to end the use of the death penalty in 2005. They did a poll before they did this and showed that there's the biggest shift in opinion among Catholics on this issue than over all the years where they've been trying to get people about abortion with that heavy top-down kind of thing of depriving politicians of communion or whatever they've been doing. On the death penalty, it's been a huge shift in Catholic opinion. And this was done in 2005. Among adult Catholics, support for the death penalty is down to 48%. Young Catholics, ages 30 and younger, it's 42%. Which means that 58% of young Catholics that are getting it through education now do not believe in the death penalty. It's been a huge shift. And you can mobilize. So what we did was we got a group of people in D.C. We met with the USCCB, with John Carr, who works with the issue of the death penalty with the bishops, and had a grassroots group of Catholics to start Catholic mobilizing network to take the bishop's campaign and get it in the classrooms and get it in the pews. And that's what this little card's all about.